The conservation biologist Michael Sewell, I'm quite possibly mispronouncing that, said, "People only say what they love." We need to show love for all that we share this planet with. It's sometimes mocked and not properly understood, but a lot of indigenous cultures still live that way. Again, it's seen as a backwards belief. But what's so progressive about destroying your only home, your non-human kin, food sources and places of pleasure? Robin Wall Kimmerer, who describes herself as a mother first, scientist and professor, asked her students, "Do you think the Earth loves you?" None of them wanted to answer. But when she rephrased it into a hypothetical question of what that love would look like, the answers were flowing and reflected the type of relationship you'd see between a human and other human. I've always felt there was a lack of love in the activist world. The division between them, in inverted commas, and the enlightened righteous us, in inverted commas. Lecturing isn't the way to go because our instinct is to usually react against being told what to do, or being made to feel that we are the bad ones causing all of this. It's complicated living in neo-capitalism, and we're all complicit to various degrees. The rage should be focused on governments and the big companies with regards to climate change and other atrocities, although I like to call it ecocide, because that's what it is. On-the-ground action, providing different solutions to the wasteful way we live, and also because it's never really shown in a positive light by the media. It's not all having to live like a hippie, you know, or denying yourself. Activism and community are sometimes described in terms of natural structures. Rhythms is one, non-hierarchical interdependence. All connections require nourishment. Your body is your source. COVID's made that place of beauty fraught with danger now, requiring calculated risks to move in the world, to touch, to heal and cope, to take pleasure. It's taken me a long time to immerse myself back into my creative practice after navigating deep grief and shock. The body, my body and my lover's body, has been my focus and my anchor, my pleasure and area of exploration. Joanna Hedva, the writer, quoted somebody, and terribly I can't find the source or remember, but basically the woman was saying that coping is a better word to use than healing, because healing is dismissive of all the continuous issues that we face. I feel that sometimes we use the word healing because it's such a profound change from before. Sometimes we can fully heal from things, but it's not like we can forget memories, and the body stores memories and stresses and hurts. We just learn to hold them in a different way, like grief. It's still a powerful quote because until we're collectively healing, we're not healed. We're still living here in this society. It's okay to crumble. It's okay to cry and do nothing for hours, for days. Some of us can't, though. Support and self-care are highly important. Allowing yourself to be emotionally vulnerable and open in the spaces you feel safe. It's important to make the time to stoke your inner fire. What makes you feel alive? What gives you strength and passion? What or who makes you radiate? Are you able to be your authentic self? And if not, why not? I dropped the thread of being an artist over various stages of my life, outwardly giving lots and doing things that weren't traditionally art, though still creative. My family have always massaged each other, heads, necks, shoulders, backs, intuitively. I took a professional course in Swedish massage last year. It seemed like the natural thing to do. And it changed my life and brought a new depth and understanding to my work, as well as personal and sexual life. So here we have the vagus nerve. Breathing to de-stress is a great basic skill to learn, and also one that you can do anywhere. Deep breathing stimulates the vagus nerve. We have 12 craniosacral nerves, and the vagus is tense, is also one of my absolute favourites. Vagus means wanderer, thus named as it interweaves through every organ in the body. The vagus nerve controls the parasympathetic response. The nervous system functions through our emotions and physical reactions, and the fight or flight response is an ancient one. It can manifest in various ways, such as rushing around worrying, slumping with exhaustion, or anxiety. Regulating the nervous system and completing the cycle to come down will help immensely. A damaging belief is just a thought pattern that you can train yourself out of. Chronic stress will have you focusing on what you see as threatening and in a heightened state, and in turn will affect all of your body. Calming down your stressful physiological response and finding what areas in your life you find joy in. Where do you feel safe? Where do you feel deeply happy? Who makes you feel this way? So I'll show you some basic hand and foot massaging techniques. So you can use any sort of oil, sunflower, almond. Just make sure that you're not allergic to it. Hand creams, anything oily. So start by coating your hands and forearms with a light coating. Start by, this is called friction, and then basically treat your fingers like udders. Use the pressure that suits you. You can go hard or soft, or just build up and just rub all the areas on your palm. And it's called friction when you do that to your fingers. Just massaging the joints, and here we have this is the carpals. And if you're doing lots of computer work, you'll probably be aching, so you just rub that. And if it hurts too much, just lessen the pressure. Always make sure that you have your ergonomic setup done correctly. A slight tilt of the neck can give you lots of pain afterwards, and leaning on your carpals can just, not good. So friction the joints of your fingers going all the way up. Normally you'd support the whole arm with a rolled up pillow or support cushion, but it's fine just to do it this way as well, as long as you're not causing yourself any damage. And press in between the bones of your finger joints and your fingers on the top of your hand and work your way up again. You can increase the pressure, and if it hurts, stop doing it. Up towards the top of the elbow is where a lot of people don't focus or think, and it can be incredibly relieving to do that. I'm doing this a bit fast for purposes of the video, but you can take as much time as you need. I mean, 15 minutes is just utterly amazing. So I'm doing the same to the other hand. Balancing your body out is a recommended thing to do, or you just feel off kilter. Move the muscle up, feel like you're kneading dough. I'd finish with a sweep up after that. Just really give that a good workout and then start kneading your fingers again. You can go over the joint, but don't bend it. If you were getting your hands done by a professional and they had the support underneath them, you'd be bending the fingers back to a comfortable position, and that lets the synovial fluid back into your joints. Again, we don't really think of how much strain and work our hands and fingers do. I mean, I could just spend a long time doing just this. I've actually never soaked my hands in Epsom salts. I might try that. Although I do have Epsom salt baths. It's the magnesium. Highly recommended. It's not just for old people. And this move in between your finger joints actually feels really good too. More effleurage. It's like you're kind of sending the fluids back up. And in between your fingers. You're basically chasing your toes in this same manner. You'd think with all the hand washing we're doing it would be relaxing, but no, it's not. And this will be a good counter remedy to that. Just giving them some slow love and care and attention. And much needed moisturiser. Stretching, shaking things out. Bending. That feels good too. Again, if you were seeing a therapist, your whole, it would be like being weightless and they'd be manipulating your joints backwards. And to finish off, you can squeeze the nails. It's also very good for stress relief. You'd be surprised how much your fingertips can get tired. Just give them a little wiggle. Jam-packed with nerve endings. Very hard-working. And again, something that we don't really do. Tired little fingers. And then afterwards, just go back and hold them a bit longer. And squeeze. Again, mirror what you do on both sides. Feet. Okay, so get yourself into a comfortable position, have your oil ready, whatever you're using, and begin by just giving yourself a light coating. You don't want too much, you don't want to be sliding around. You just want to have a bit of a glide and sweeping strokes up the way towards your heart. You want to treat your toes the same way you did your fingers. You want to be squeezing all the way up them, all sides of them, the joints and spaces in between. I'm doing this slightly faster because of the video, but you can take as much time as you want. Stretching them out. You can do a wiggle as well, which is, depending on your joint health. If you have gout, actually, do not massage your toes. It will hurt. You can skip to the other ones though. And again, as much pressure as you feel comfortable with. If you've had any breakages in the last few months, then don't be doing this at all. Reflexology divides your foot into 4 or 5 quadrants, all of which relate to different parts of the body. And I might talk about that in the other videos. Acupressure. Again, strokes all the way up. And just really work into all areas of the underside of the foot. Squeezing the sides, again, I feel that's a place that's not touched at all unless you're specifically doing this, but it feels so good. It takes a lot of strain and pressure. Stretching out. And it's nice just to feel the warmth of your hands. Good to use 2 hands. I actually never ever went for pedicures. I mean, it was a bitch tag, not my thing. But now that I've switched, I've been exploring femininity and thought I would try that. And it was amazing. I've never had such attention paid to my feet and they just felt so light afterwards. But it's all things you can do at home for yourself too. Again, if you've time. Sanding out calluses, soaking your feet. Okay, nail polish might take a bit longer. So stretching out the foot with both hands, like you're kind of, squeezing an avocado open. Do we do that? You know the motion, it's like you're stretching apart the bones in your foot. And just work in as much as you need to, like all the achy parts. You'll feel it when you go with that. Pay attention to the heel, ankle bone, and your Achilles heel as well. All areas that take a lot of daily strain. And don't forget the top of your foot as well. Same thing with the fingers, it's going between the kind of the bones of your toes. Just go along them. And again, roll your calf muscles. And then finish with a sweeping stroke upwards. Effleurage. Ideally, you'll have done this after a bath or shower. Clean feet help. And if you have problems using your fingers, then you can use the heel of your hand. There's also a technique called layering, I think. I can't quite remember now. But you're basically placing one finger on top of the other, so you're kind of giving it extra strength. And you can use that to do the kind of friction parts with extra pressure and safety for your fingers. Love takes effort, understanding, communicating, expansion and growth. Some people can love just one person, but I feel that comes with rare satisfaction on multiple levels. Though it seems that people compromise out of fear and loneliness, They neither learn to live with their own happiness or take matters into their own hands, secretly. The empowered woman is seen as dangerous and degraded as much as possible. Slut, whore, cunt, witch. A lot of people have been turning to magic as a support during these times. It's an act of self-empowerment, of hope and belief in change. Pleasure is a radical act of defiance. We all look in different ways, listen in different ways. We all know about the white gaze, the male gaze, but there's also the ways women look, the way survivors look, the ways black, indigenous, people of colour look, observing the landscape for potential threats, routes to safety, how things are moving, breathing, for the glimmers of joy and wonder. The way we look for joy during the pandemic is just as important and necessary. The importance of what gives you passion, taking the time to be creative. What gives me passion and pleasure? Aligning with nature, pleasure in all forms, reciprocity, stillness. You might be making assumptions about what you're seeing right now. Masks take dedication, a leap into the new. It's also about protection as well as a deep ecstatic joy, textures and smells. It relates to my piece as I'll be taking photographs and film footage of people wearing different masks and head coverings, in a way hiding from the pain of what's going on in the world. In the meantime, we also need pleasure. There are multiple ways of finding it. But what keeps me going and connected to the land, the sky, the world, the universe, is sex. Not just any old sex, but what I've been lucky to find with my lover. It's rare and magical. Flow. The body has always been my source of comfort, exploration and pleasure. In this time, a touch is now dangerous. There are also different ways of touching and connecting with your body. Robin Wall Kimmerer also wrote that for the first time we as a species are biologically vulnerable and that perhaps it will foster a sense of empathy and understanding with all life forms that we share this planet with. They face that every day. Why is it useful to identify as an artist? Is it like a charm for the self? A magical, complicated act and way of being? You don't have to be an artist to bring a sensibility and an awareness to the world around you. What's truly perverse to me, aside from the usual moral transgressions, is the society that we live in. Shame and meta-feeling, like feeling bad about being happy. You can't always remove the shame, but you can control the meta-feeling, the sub-feeling. Anal play and sex has never been taboo for me. It's just another part of the body, as are all the fluids. Tantra considers all bodily fluids as sacred, and I like to think that it's in my DNA and I'm connecting to my ancestral roots. Tantra also embraces death, Eros and Thanatos. I've accepted the risk being that he has a primary partner as well as me. I've seen my lover during this pandemic. Calculated risk is a turn on for us both. We have furiously intense sex after funerals, diving into the pulsing, seeping life force, connecting us to the universe. I've always thought if we were in a war zone, we'd be fucking whilst bombs dropped around us. Two degenerate atoms vibrating on the same plane. Sun, moon, stars, and the hunger. To hold you in a single breath. I only get to see him randomly and for a shorter time now, but in between I pay attention to my desires in a solo fashion. You have to balance out pleasure too, though. Ironically, I've reached a peak and now need time to be quiet and still, with no touching, just different sorts of nourishing self-care and love. Reading, going out for walks, cooking, lying still, sleeping with the moonlight on me. All that's invisible to our limited senses and fills the air around us. When I synced with rotting season, the smell of fresh raw honeycomb lifted out of the hive, warm, sticky fluid, the heat of the bees. How a smell can transport you. The lusciousness of feeling you against my cervix, and as it tightened around you. Pissing outside. Problem solving, natural water filtration. Spending hours thinking of all the things we can do, all that we've done in the past. Cool, crisp bed linen. When sex and spirituality were fully integrated into daily life. Temple whores. Witchy woman. Watching something you've planted and tended blossom. That I inspire, trust and relax people and get to hear their innermost thoughts and desires. Deep honesty and raw openness. Pushing boundaries and exploring. Those that are connected to the inner and outer world. Thoughtful romantics. I love your words. Getting dressed up for you. Knowing that what I'm doing with my intimate knowledge of the body is causing you to change and melt. Strutting down the street whilst oozing my inner sexual self. The way your voice changes when you tell me to bend over. The tickle of your hair on my inner wrist. Watching you twitch. Watching you spurt. Watching your eyes widen. And the smile spread across your face. Walking hand in hand. Eye gazing, bookshops and river walks, bodies wrapped up together, lying around, talking, drinking, eating, sharing, laughing, being in nature, watching the weather roll across the valley, bird migrations in return, the excitement of catching a bat flitting around me at night. Feeling the sexual energy of all living things fill the air, thick and ripe. Feeling the ancestral lineage, sexually, creatively, politically. Riding the ghost in the machine, the chaos and bringing it to a tamed state. What it takes in life to bring two people together, the synchronicity, the chance and coincidence, the universe moving. Magical numbers, beats, covering you in my fluids, taking your fluids, my heels pressed to your sides, the way you smile when you see what I've worn for you, port-calling, having sex next to the sea and open fires, building with you, snowboarding. Golden flowers, gold leaf, having sex in the golden sunlight or dusk, sex magic.